Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for being here. Today, it's a pleasure to introduce Massimo, Max Gaspari. Massimo will talk to us about raining onto galaxies and supermassive black holes. So basically, a kind of weather. What's the weather around supermassive black holes and galaxies? Massimo, if you're ready, you can go.
First of all, I'd like to thank a lot, Francesco, really, for giving me the opportunity to give this talk. And I know Francesco since many years, and we have done great works. And I think we are very lucky to have Francesco over there at Tor Vergata. So it's really a pleasure to give this virtual talk, although, of course, you can feel I'm over there at Tor Vergata. So let's jump into it. And today I'd like to discuss and give you a brief overview, a little bit of review of this process known as raining onto galaxies and supermassive black holes. So there has been many studies, as you have seen, and one of the key topics that I will stress a lot is how we can link all the different processes at different scales. But before that, let's make a jump back, and I want to give a fairly broad introduction. So I'm pretty sure there are several students over there. And of course, if you have any questions, also let Francesco know, and I'm happy to be interrupted throughout the talk, so if you have any. So starting from high redshift, so we are in the far universe here. So you can see here, this is one of the many cosmological simulations that we have nowadays. And you can see that at several billion years ago, in time, so high redshift, we form these so-called proto-galaxies, proto-groups, and proto-clusters. So this is simple, really dark matter, so collisionless physics. So only gravity is basically involved over there. But you can see on the right-hand side, as the time progresses, how the gas, so the baryons, start to fall onto these dark matter halos. And you can see pretty clearly that this gas heats up to temperatures here between 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8 Kelvin. And you also see many, many different features also of these explosions, which is related to the response of the supermassive black hole at the center of each galaxy. So what are observations actually seeing in the past 10, 20 years? So Chandra and XMM have given us these great observations in the X-ray band. Indeed, all these diffuse halos mainly shine in X-ray due to, we will see later, mainly Bremsstrahlung emission. So, and you can see here some collection of these hot halos. I put here some halos in same determinate regime, so in galaxy groups, but of course we have seen first these hot halos in very massive clusters like this one. And you can also see all the different features already here. So we have bubbles, shocks, gas entrainment. We will tackle these features step by step in the next slides. Before jumping into this kind of more detailed physics, I wanted to show you this plot, which is a fairly simple plot. So X-ray luminosity versus the stellar mass in each of basically the halos. So you should imagine that at the center, we have all the stars, and then, of course, the diffuse gas goes beyond, say, so to speak, the galaxy or even the group of galaxies. So, and on the upper panel, you see here the temperature of the gas. So, 1 kV is roughly 10 to the 7 Kelvin. So, and you can see that in astrophysics, we have many different terminologies for these kinds of diffuse halos. So at the high mass end, so with several kV, so several 10 to the 7 Kelvin, we have the so-called intracluster medium, okay? So if we go down the scale, of course, in mass, both in temperature and in total mass or stellar mass, we enter the intragroup medium, and then, of course, the interstellar medium or circumgalactic medium. So this is to say we use different acronyms, but in the end, really, the gas is always the same. It's a highly ionized gas, so a plasma, which fills all these potential wells. Also to convince you of another key feature, that not only these hot halos are really important for the large-scale structure of course, of the universe. But at the center of each halo, typically we have a supermassive black hole with masses here between 10 to the 7 and 10 to the 10, even more, solar masses. So it means that, and the black hole is really tiny. I'll show you later in a diagram that we have 19 orders of magnitude difference in scale between, say, the black hole and the large-scale hot halo. But apparently, so in this plot that comes out from a recent work that we did on correlations between all the different properties of galaxies, groups, and clusters, and the central black hole, you can see how there is this tight correlation in the black hole mass and the X-ray temperature of the hot halo. Okay. So in the past, say, 20 years, so originally, many correlations were discovered, in particular related to the stellar components. So you can see here the stellar, the black hole mass compared to the velocity dispersion of the stars or the luminosity of the stars. And you can see there is a correlation, but with some scatter, right? So typically here 0.4, even up to 0.5 decks. But here are the analogs of the same plot, so again, the correlations. So if we plot the black hole mass with the X-ray temperature or X-ray luminosity, you see how these correlations are much, much tighter. So we can play a lot of statistical tools, but the key point here is really to show you that there is this tight correlation between black hole mass and in particular the hot halos. So these diffuse gases, these diffuse halos are extremely important at the cosmological level, but also at the level of the central black holes. So here is kind of the overview diagram that I like to show many times. So it kind of encapsulates my program, which is called Black Hole Weather. And in this program, what we are trying to do is two goals. First of all, to have first principle multi-scale simulations. Show you later an example. So this means to really study the physics in each of these areas that we will tackle in a moment. And at the same time, the second goal is to have detailed synthetic models. So out of these simulations, we want, say, mock observations, which can be compared, say, apples to apples with real multi-wavelength data. So in terms of as overview, as you can see here, we have the black hole at the center of each halo. So typically, we started from central galaxies, say, in a large-scale halo, but this can be applied really to any kind of, say, compact object or black hole and its extended atmosphere. So we have a black hole, and of course, the key problem is to link this black hole physics, say, up to the astrophysics and, of course, cosmology of each galaxy, group, and cluster. So as you can see here, in terms of, say, Virya radius or even Schwarzschild radius, we can reach up to 9 or 10 orders of magnitude in spatial scale, but of course this is the same in temporal scale. So very challenging problem, and of course this has to be divided in different sub-areas that I'm plotting here, and I will tackle sequentially in this talk the different parts. So over here we have 1 and 2 is called the feeding part, so which concerns with how much gas is really falling onto the supermassive black hole, how much gas can we accrete onto the, say, compact object. So, and we have, of course, the macro feeding and then micro feeding. And at the same time, though, we have seen throughout, in particular, X-ray observations, where we have a huge amount of energy, in particular, kinetic energy, but also radiative energy, coming out of black holes. Indeed, these actually are called active galactic nuclei, so, or AGN. I will talk a lot about AGN, but in the end, is really a black hole doing the response back to the entire galaxy. So we have micro feedback, macro feedback, and of course, then the ultimate goal is to link the feeding and the feedback in a self-regulated loop, which is, of course, very difficult due to the scales involved. Now, a step back on how we can really progress in the field and what is my particular and favorite tool of investigation are essentially hydrodynamical simulations or magnetodynamical simulations. And typically when we say simulation, we hear that it's very complicated feature, but in the end, what we are solving at the core of simulations is just conservation equations. And to give you a feeling, these are kind of basic Euler equations. So we have conservation of mass per unit volume, and momentum, energy, and some equation of state. Okay, so these are fixed conservation equations. On the right hand side, the role of the astrophysicist and numerical physicist is to kind of test all the different source terms that you can see here, from cooling to heating, dark matter, and star formation. So in all these simulations, of course, things become highly nonlinear as you introduce more and more terms. But the key part that I like to stress a lot, and that is personally my approach, is to use simulations really as control experiments. So trying to test the physics step by step, and then you scale up to the more complex simulations. So throughout the talk, I won't go into the details of the numerics, but I want to remark that there are many different types of codes, ranging from pure grid codes to particle codes and an intermediate range between the two. My favorite type of codes are typically Eulerian codes or grid codes, but with the feature of having adaptive mesh refinement, or AMR. You can see here, AMR is simply some kind of zoom in and nested grids toward the regions of interest. So you can see here a torus evolution and all the different refinement grids. Also, grid codes have, first of all, the disadvantage to be fairly slow, but the advantage is that since they are really computing sort of exact problem in terms of integral form of the applications, we can study very well shocks and discontinuities and other properties of highly compressible flows. And indeed, all these diffuse halos are highly compressible and are even, of course, highly ionized. Now, let's jump into the different areas. And I'd like to spend quite some time on this macro feeding, because indeed the macro feeding is really the key component of the entire cycle. And there has been many, many different studies in the past years that I like to highlight a little bit. So, and we have this, nowadays it's called training in simple terms, but in, say, technical terms, it's more, you should think this as really multi-phase condensation cascade. Now, to give you an example of a simple, say, more than simple kind of intermediate simulation that we usually run, this is, we take some kind of box, typically enveloping a galaxy, or even more, a group or a cluster, and then we zoom in onto the central supermassive black hole with a range of, in this case, a million, and it's getting more and more, let's say, at higher resolution with just the raw computational power that we have. So, and typically, as I said, we have some kind of stellar component, and of course, embedded within a macro scale dark matter halo. But really, the key part, of course, is to understand the feeding and later on even the feedback onto the supermassive black hole. So you can start with many different types of initial conditions. We often like to start from observed initial conditions, but you can do many different things, like starting from actual cosmological simulations and having more, say, realistic and perturbed initial conditions. So let's see how the feeding proceeds in a sequential way. And as I said, I typically use simulations as controlled experiments. So here is an example of this feeding simulation. It's very simple. So again, you should think that this is just a tiny fraction of the cube. We have 100 kiloparsec cube, and at the center, there is the black hole. So very simple setup here. There is just a hot halo, and it's just a quiescent halo. So essentially almost no kinematics. And you can see that, of course, we have this very simple spherically symmetric accretion, very smooth, very quiescent. And this accretion is called the Bondi accretion. So highly idealized, because as you can imagine here, it's so we basically eliminated any kind of physics except for the gravity and the pressure of the hot halo. So if we introduce a little bit of turbulence or any kind of kinematics in these hot halos, so what you see here is the production of all these turbulent eddies. So you can think of this as really angular momentum. So you inject any kind of chaotic angular momentum, or you can inject any kind of ordered angular momentum, say like in spiral galaxies. The net result, you can see here, this is the accretion rate as a function of time. The net result is that any kind of rotation and angular momentum will, of course, decrease your accretion rate. So this is, as I said, the pure Bondi evolution, and this is the decrease due to these different types of rotations and angular momentum. So this is to say that in a pure hot mode accretion, which has been used many times, say, in the past, between 2012, this kind of Bondi accretion and hot mode accretion has been shown to be very low level, very smooth, and hence it's very difficult to, we'll see later, to self-regulate the entire system in a very efficient way. Moreover, we know that the hot halos are not only, of course, say in hydrostatic equilibrium within the potential, but we know that they are emitting radiation, right? So because we see them in the X-ray. So it means that they emit strongly in the X-ray. Indeed, so you can approximate the, say, cooling rate, it's called. So what you see is also the cooling of the gas. So how much you emit, you lose in terms of internal energy. And it's simply the function of the square of the density, but also a cooling function, lambda it's called, that you can see over here at different, very wide range of temperatures. So in the X-ray, we are over here, so it emits strongly in Bremsstrahlung emission, but below 10 to the 7 Kelvin, as we approach UV and of course the optical range, we have all the different line cooling. So Bremsstrahlung is free-free emission. All here we have, of course, all bound, free-free bound, bound-bound emission types. Okay, so all these are different types of recombination lines, for instance, helium, and then we enter, for instance, hydrogen recombination around over here in this peak. And of course, after the gas is no more strongly ionized, we enter the neutral cooling, which is highly inefficient. And of course, later on down to the molecular phase, even more inefficient, although the gas is extremely dense. And if you proceed over here, of course, then the gas goes down and collapses, forming stars and so on and so forth. But this is the main sequence. So you should think that the gas proceeds from the hot temperatures, typically down to the cooler temperatures. What are the evidences of this kind of cooling? So there are many observational studies, of course, in the past two, three decades or more, because we can trace this kind of condensation in the much easier optical, infrared, and even UV spectra compared with the X-ray spectra. So we have many more photons, and as you can see here, the classic example is Perseus galaxy cluster, where we observe all these extended filamentary structures, and these can reach up to 100 kiloparsec from, this is the central galaxy or BCG. Okay. But of course, these are kind of the giant monsters. So what we observe most of the times are these kind of structures, especially in groups, where the emission is more compact, and all the filaments, of course, are on smaller scales and are not so vigorously seen as in galaxy clusters. So, of course, now with ALMA, with this exquisite resolution of ALMA, we have been able to go down even further and to study cold molecular clouds, similarly as done here in our own Milky Way. We are starting to see since several years now, all these different condensation or giant molecular associations in many, many galaxies, even in massive galaxies that typically are thought to be, say, in the classic view, are thought to be red and dead. Now, back to the simulations here. So we have seen the hot mode. What happens in so-called cold mode accretion? So we have, again, the hot halo, but now we allow the halo to cool through the radiative emission that I showed you in the previous slide. So if the halo is rotating, you have, of course, condensation happens onto the equatorial region, and it forms this sort of thin disks onto the equatorial region. So again, you can see the accretion rate here normalized to the cooling rate. It's just one solar mass per year, for instance, here. But you see that the accretion rate is continuously suppressed by several orders of magnitude as the time evolves. Again, this is simply due to the angular momentum barrier at the center. So very difficult to accrete the gas with some angular momentum and no other process. So instead, on the opposite spectrum, say, of extreme models, we have the so-called pure cooling flow model. And this kind of cooling flow model has led, in particular in the 80s and 90s, to many troubles, because the key problem was that in a purely cooling halo, as you can see here, the entire core of the galaxy in terms of gas condenses and collapses down to the center. And not only this, of course, grows a lot the supermassive black hole, but of course the entire cooling rate is huge. So we would observe cooling rates through X-ray spectra of hundreds or thousands solar masses per year, which are completely ruled out in essentially all systems, except maybe one strange system known as Phoenix. Now, the intermediate case is the more realistic case. So as we have seen before in the initial simulation, you could have appreciated that the hot halos are highly turbulent. So it's very difficult to keep a coherent rotation or a spherically symmetric configuration. So the more medium situation of hot halos is this kind of turbulent environment. So, and I would say the key step forward, at least since 2012, 2013, has been to understand that really this kind of turbulence, which I remind is even just subsonic turbulence in hot halos. We are not even talking about supersonic turbulence. So we are talking about hundreds kilometers per second, as found recently by Itomi. So these kind of turbulent motions are really key to induce this kind of a different accretion process, which is technically known as chaotical accretion, as acronym is CCA. But the key, say, in simple terms, you could think of this kind of accretion really as raining onto the central black hole and even the galaxy, for obvious reasons that I will explain in a moment. So to give you the sense of how much chaotic this system is, you can already here appreciate the chaotic streamlines that all these clouds follow during this CCA evolution. So in simple terms, you could think of our own precipitation here on Earth. So essentially, when you have turbulent atmosphere, any kind of turbulence creates some kind of overdensity locally. So and this kind of overdensity stimulates more radiative cooling. We have seen that the cooling rate is proportional to the square of the density. And so emitting more radiation means that the gas collapses, and it's sort of mini condensation phase, but not as a general pure cooling flow, but as a mini localized condensation process. And you can see here that we form extended warm filaments and cold molecular clouds out of this hot halo. And these are very chaotic clouds that we will see that will inelastically collide in the very central region. So this process that I will go into the details now was proposed several years ago, but there are many different studies, not only from our group throughout the years, that have corroborated this kind of process from both the theoretical and observational point of view. Here are some references, but there has been many, many more in the past years. So it seems that CCA is really a key process in boosting the accretion rate of black holes. But what are the evidences? So, and how can we probe this kind of process compared with other, say, Bondi accretion process or thin disk accretion process? So there are two key properties that are worth to investigate. The first of all is thermodynamics, and second, the kinematics. So in thermodynamics, we are concerned mainly with the imaging of the different phases. So reminder that in this kind of process of precipitation, of raining, we traverse all the different phases. So from the X-ray to the optical and down to the molecular gas. So we can use all the multi-wavelength telescopes and observations to test this kind of process. So, and as I said before, so we produced a synthetic observation. So one of these, for instance, is the synthetic imaging in the soft X-ray and in the hard X-ray. So in the hard X-ray, you would see, so hard X-ray, it means several kV. So you would observe all these kind of turbulent eddies and depression. So it's mainly the turbulence that drives the hot halo. So not a major result, but in the soft X-ray, you would start to observe the first filamentary structures that are basically the initial phase of this kind of condensation. But more interestingly, as I showed you before in some images, the gas condenses rapidly down to 10 to the 4 Kelvin, essentially. So we reach the optical and UV phase, and you see how these images show you all these filamentary structures up to here several kiloparsec, but in clusters can be even larger, as Perseus cluster. Of course, these filaments are highly ionized, so you should think of these optical UV emitting filaments as really the thin skin surrounding the neutral and warm phase. That is very difficult to observe because this is very thin and very compact compared with the ionized warm phase, which emits strongly in optical and UV. Then we go down, and the next phase, as I said, the top-down multiphase condensation is the molecular phase. So in the radio band, we would observe all these different, of course, clumps. And most of these are giant molecular associations. In the center, these are, of course, single clouds. Typically, these clouds are not so different from our own Milky Way clouds in terms of surface density, but the total, of course, amount of molecular gas in this kind of galaxies is much, much lower than our own galaxy by at least 2 or 3 orders of magnitude. Also, you can notice how these clouds are already very chaotic at the center, and you should think as these clouds really as our own clouds over here, so they are not static entities, they are not bullets falling onto the black hole, they are really dynamically supported structures. So it means that the turbulent pressure is very important, which is inherited from the original turbulent hot halo, and so you should think of these clouds continuously expanding and contracting, and then, of course, interacting between each other. So here again, some ALMA images I like to show a lot this kind of NGC 5044, which is a massive galaxy in a fairly nearby system. Now, the other part to test CCA is the kinematics. So here, instead, we use a spectra. And we know from spectra that they have many different, of course, lines, but there are two key properties of spectra, which is essentially the shift of the line compared to the rest frame. And the shift tells you the bulk motions that you have in the gas. So you can use, again, any different kind of lines, emitting lines. We use a lot H-alpha lines and N2 lines, for instance, in optical. And so the other feature is the broadening of the line. So the broadening of the line tells you the intrinsic turbulence that you have in the gas. Okay, so what I'm showing here is how the gas behaves through the different phases. In particular, on the y-axis you have the warm phase, on the x-axis you have the hot phase. Okay, and I'm showing here the velocity dispersion or the turbulence, say, broadening of the line, so not the shift. So how much turbulent the gas is. In particular, so this velocity dispersion should think over an ensemble of clouds, okay? So a very large beam in terms of observational detection. So over here at low velocity dispersion, so a few tens kilometers per second, we are in the low feeding phase, so very low rain, and also we'll see very low feedback. While over here we have in a very vigorous kind of precipitation and very vigorous feedback from the black hole. But regardless of the different cycles that the simulation goes through throughout all these blue points, you can see that there is a fairly tight correlation between the different phases, in particular here the warm and the entire hot phase. And again, you should think that really these warm filaments as ensemble trace the entire turbulent hot halo. And later on, I'm not showing this, but all the different phases down to molecular and of course infrared and UV, all more or less trace each other with some degree of different scatters. So we can use nowadays, but also in the very near future, all these beautiful instruments in all the different bands, for instance, of course, Athena in the X-ray, ALMA right now, JWST, infrared, BLT, Muse already now, fantastic instrument to test all the different lines. And we can correlate all the different kinematics between the different phases to test which mechanism is at play in the different halos. So in more detail, how we can do that. So it is more detailed than I want typically in a talk, but to show you that when we go down to the details, of course, things become more complicated. For instance, in this plot, we have the line broadening, again, the velocity dispersion that I showed you before, and then we have the line shift, or again, the line of sight velocity shifted, and so the bulk motion of the gas. So, and these are the contours, the 1, 2, 3 sigma contours of the simulations. And then, of course, these are the red points, are all the observed systems. In this case, it was VMOS IFU, again, through H alpha line. So you can see that as ensemble, of course, the simulations reproduce fairly well the entire, say, sample, in this case, of massive galaxies. So as a general, say, overview, we can say that the multi-phase condensation and CCA holds fairly well. Then if we go to the, say, small-scale feature, like in a pencil beam approach, so instead of taking the entire ensemble beam, we take the single clouds out of these diffuse halos, of course, the scatter increases a lot. So because over here, we intersect clouds that are, say, drifting in the turbulent halo, again, similar to the macro-scale turbulence. But then we start to intersect also clouds that we also call black hole shadows, that essentially they have very high velocities and very low turbulence, intrinsic turbulence. And indeed, if we go into the simulations, we see that all these clouds are really the clouds falling toward the supermassive black hole, so within the very inner region. And with ALMA, you can probe this with very high accuracy. For instance, all these three clouds were first shown in this paper by Grant Tremblay in 2016 and 18 in A2597. And you can see how these lines are very narrow and they are related to these infalling clouds toward the black hole. So speaking of which brings me to the microfeeding. So in the microfeeding, we are concerned on how really these clouds fall and are accreted, say, below the parsec scale and then down to the milliparsec scale. So I'm showing here some plot, which is called a clump finder plot, which displays the densest structures in this CCA rain. And you can see how these clumps, they really fill the inner region, especially within 50 or 100 parsecs from the black hole. And all these clouds, of course, as you can imagine, they start to collide inelastically, very rapidly. And sometimes these inelastic collisions are very efficient and they produce this 100% angular momentum cancellation. Okay. So, and canceling or mixing angular momentum by a large amount leads to the funneling of the clouds toward the black hole region. And you can see here the accretion rate normalized to the cooling rate has all these spikes up to the, say, cooling rate. So in a pure cooling flow, it would be always constant up here. In a pure hot mode accretion, so bondi accretion, it would be very low over here and also very small. While in CCA, you can see how this oscillates with very rapid variability up to these high and low quiescent states. And this really reacts to the state of this CCA rain and condensing clouds. So this rapid variability is very appealing because all the X-ray observations, but also in different bands like UV and optical, we always see that AGN are highly variable on very different scales, from seconds to even years. So, and this variability is very difficult to explain in simple and smooth models. But you can see here that in this kind of chaotic accretion mode, you always have this strong variability. And in particular, remarkably, it's a fairly simple variability. So it's called pink or flicker noise. It's this plot shows you this power spectrum of the accretion rate as a function of frequency. And this noise, which is in between white noise and, of course, brown noise, it's a simple minus one slope in this power spectrum. So, and it's simple because if you integrate this, this power spectrum over the frequencies, you have a constant variance of this noise. So it means that this simple noise is really sort of ubiquitous over one order of magnitude. You always have some kind of strong variability from, say, mega year even down to years and seconds. In several natural phenomena, not only in quasars and sunspots, but we notice that it's highly frequent in meteorological data like rainfalls and many other types of systems, even the stock market. Now, you should think then that, as a recap, that we have this condensation over here at the kiloparsec scale. All the clouds collide over here, and at some point they reach the vicinity of the supermassive black hole. So, and we essentially enter the gravitational or GR regime, so the general relativity regime within some tense gravitational radii from the supermassive black hole. And of course, here, as I showed you before, we have seen already that in X-ray, all these AGN or supermassive black hole re-eject back a lot of mass, energy, and momentum. But I wanted to show you here that by employing general relativistic radiative MHD simulation, so here, of course, we need to be more sophisticated with this kind of simulation, so very expensive. But most of the times, what we have seen in GR MHD simulations is the production of this kind of outflows. So in general, so if you have a particular configuration, say magnetic fields or spin of the black hole, you create, you can see here, some kind of collimated radio jet or highly relativistic feature. But even changing the accretion rate, say it's called Eddington rate, but say from very high accretion rate down to say 10 to minus 6 is Eddington rate. So we always find some kind of mechanical output. So this is the kinetic efficiency, so the mechanical efficiency of the black hole, which stays fairly constant over different physics and types of simulations. So we always have some kind of a few percent efficiency of the black hole re-ejecting back mass, momentum, and energy. So the mechanism is highly unknown. So there is a competition, as I said, of magnetic fields, and radiative pressure, and of course even thermal pressure within the over here the central regions, and so it's still unknown which dominates over which. But what we clearly see that say at hundreds gravitational radii, we always have some kind of kinetic feedback. So we always have some kind of say outflow with varying velocities. So and in X-ray in particular, Francesco, for instance, has contributed a lot in this field with many others. X-ray, we take these X-ray spectra and we look at iron lines, which are very prominent. You see here iron 26. And so probing only the spectra of this, say, point source AGN, you can probe the very inner outflows. And typically, these outflows are highly blue shifted. And so it means that this can reach very high velocities, even up to several 10,000 kilometers per second and 0.2, 0.3 the speed of light. Okay, so very fast outflows. At the same time, you should think that we see also this kind of very collimated radio jets. So, but I want to pass on to the macro feedback because, again, on the micro scale, there are several uncertainties. On the macro feedback, we know many more features since. For instance, with Chandra, we can resolve fairly well the different properties of this macro feedback evolution. So as I said, again, to recap, CCA triggers this strong feedback response over here, and the outflow or jet gets gradually entrained, of course, in the atmosphere, because as I said, the gas is diffuse, but the column density, of course, over several orders of magnitude becomes more and more ingent. So, and you have some kind of deceleration of the outflow, and at the same time, of course, the outflow decelerates and somehow deposits the energy over here at the galactic or group scale, so converting essentially kinetic to thermal energy. But how does this work? So, this mechanism is also fairly complicated, and there has been many studies in the past two decades, and of course stimulated again by these wonderful X-ray telescopes as Chandra and XMM. And throughout the different simulations, I would highlight three key components of this feedback cycle. So the first one is the so-called X-ray bubble or X-ray cavity. So as you can imagine over here, the gas, the outflow entrains more and more gas. And at some point, as I said, the thermal, say, pressure of the hot halo balances the run pressure of the outflow. And so you form this kind of extended and wide bubbles. It's fairly similar as you are starting, you should think, boiling water, right? So, and you would start to see all the, here we see, of course, the largest bubbles, but when we have very deep observations, we can see all the different kinds of generations of bubbles, one essentially within each other or below or above each other. So, and these, of course, bubbles contain a lot of internal energy, and this internal energy or enthalpy is then, of course, that in intermediate scales or large scales, as the bubble is essentially disrupted by the turbulent flow. The second process through which the AGN feedback deposits the energy is certainly through weak shocks. So the outflow compresses a lot of the gas, and you can see here in this synthetic observation, and you form, of course, shocks. So these shocks are actually not so strong, say, in terms of, say, hydrodynamics. So the typical Mach number, so the transition from, say, a sound wave is around, of course, is Mach 1. But here we see weak shocks of the order of Mach numbers between 1.1 and 1.7. So you should think of these weak shocks really as more like sound waves. So you have a strong bubbles, but also these, so to speak, recurrent and, say, weak shocks. And you can see here, for instance, this is a clear case of these cocoon shocks enveloping the bubbles inside this massive galaxy cluster. Of course, it's not always clear like this. And then the third component is, as we have seen before, and now Itomi has revealed directly through the broadening of the iron lines in X-ray spectra, is that we have a significant amount of turbulence in the hot halo. So not only cosmological turbulence, but this AGN feedback is able to inject turbulence of the order of hundreds kilometers per second in these diffuse halos. Okay. And speaking of turbulence, I wanted to highlight this recent work done with Denis Vitor over here. And the one of the key properties that we try to understand in this kind of feedback turbulence regime is a so-called entropy. So entropy is just, you should think entropy as the magnitude of the vorticity, the magnitude of turbulence. So all these panels show you where the turbulence or the entropy is really injected over different scales and different events over the say, cycles of the AGN feedback. And also the key missing physics, you can see how things become more and more complicated because turbulence can be divided, or better, entropy can be subdivided in many different physical terms. For instance, the stretching of stretching motions of this kind of entropy evolution, or the compressive or decompressive motions of the feedback, or the baroclinic term of these turbulent motions, okay? So when we do the simulations, of course, at the macro scale, things are fairly simple, but as you dig deeper and deeper, of course, each term contributes in different ways. And this is really difficult to extract because all these terms interact in nonlinear way. So you can see here that in terms of relative values, the turbulence acts mainly through the stretching term as a positive term. And of course, the red points are decompression. So it's actually rarefactions here that balance out the stretching terms. Okay, all the other terms, like baroclinic terms, are essentially irrelevant. So this is, again, to show you that we have bubbles, shocks, and turbulence. But what we are really missing, and in closing this loop, and of course the talk, I wanted to discuss fairly briefly the final point, which is the self-regulation. So how can we link the feeding and the feedback process? So again, in a pure cooling flow evolution, we only have a catastrophic collapse of the entire hot halo. And you can see here in a typical massive galaxy, in X-ray brightness or in density, you form this very dense and highly emitting cores that we don't see in any part of the galaxy. But as we discussed in the recent slides, so we have the competition between feeding and feedback, which creates some kind of self-regulation. So there are many different models, but I wanted to show you probably the most consistent, which is this one of cooling a little bit through the CCA rain that you can see here. All these clumps, although at low resolution, are all cross-sections of the clouds and filaments coming out of the condensation. So we have seen that with the high resolution simulations that all these clouds feed the inner engine. And as the black hole reacts back, you can see all these jets and outflows that pump the energy and mass back. And of course, we have seen also, particularly through extreme observations, all the different features that allow the deposition of energy at the tens kiloparsec scale. So, and before concluding, I wanted to show you this plot. So several years ago, when I wrote the PhD thesis, I wrote this kind of fairly provocative title, which was Solving the Cooling Flow Problem. And at the time, so we proposed this kind of, at the time it was not condensation or raining mechanism onto black hole, but it was, say, simple cold accretion that we saw with very low resolution simulations. But the key point of this work that still holds today is that in order to solve the problem, you really need two key properties. The first one is that the accretion rate must be suppressed by, say, at least 1 or 10% of the pure cooling flow. So any kind of heating mechanism can do that. But the key part, which is extremely difficult, and this is a requirement to be consistent with most observations, is that cool cores must be preserved for several billion years. So we don't want to destroy at each injection of this heating mechanism the entire galaxy or hot halo. So it's very difficult to maintain a state in which you are basically cooling a little bit, but at the same time heating a little bit the macroscale halo. And this turns out by testing all the different models. Again, I'm showing here kind of the low resolution CCA version at the time of several years ago. But the point was that in the mood that I showed, when you have a little bit of this CCA condensation, the inner black hole can react very rapidly to the entire macroscale cooling. So, and reacting very rapidly, it means it can re-eject back energy, momentum, and mass through outflows and jets and prevent this catastrophic cooling. You can see here the jet velocity and jet power over several billion years, how chaotic again this is, but how the temperature profile or the density profile here of a massive galaxy remain fairly stable, although each event is very powerful, 10 to the 44, 45 per second, then on and off mechanism allows this, so to speak, gentle self-regulation. And so the system remains in so-called quasi-thermal equilibrium between cooling and heating. So I want to conclude here with this kind of, this sort of updated version of the diagram of the different processes that we have done also with Francesco. And there are, of course, I showed you many different simulations and observations, and those are kind of most consistent and the best results right now. But there are many, many open questions that we need to tackle in the nearby future. And of course, as you can see here, what we are really missing is that, of course, there is a macro feedback and a micro feedback. But although we understand better now these processes in the different areas, it's still very difficult to link, say, in the same simulation and same theory, the different scales. And in particular here, I added even the mesoscale, which is, say, the parsec scale. So, and both this is applies both on the feeding side, but also on the feedback side. So it's very difficult to understand how all these micro properties link exactly to the macro properties, in particular, for instance, the entrainment, how does the entrainment works, how can we produce these multi-phase outflows that we see in many observations? And the same is here. So are these really outflows in observations, or are they multi-phase inflows? So there are many open questions that range, of course, of testing more detailed physics. But I think one of the key missing points is to link the entire feeding and feedback cycle from the, say, gravitational radius up to the megaparsec scale of galaxies, groups, and clusters. And I'll stop here and I take some of your questions.